Hello, this is Andrew Olive, and welcome back to the Shadow of Shenandoah, a PEC's fellow podcast. This is episode 2, In the Valley. Today, we'll be going over the history of Shenandoah National Park's creation with Christy Kendall. By doing so, we will also start to uncover some of the more personal stories of the people that were displaced by the establishment of the park. The stories from the descendants of those that were pushed off their land so many years ago. Though these people may be gone, their memories and passion of the land they love has never faded. Some of these stories come from people like Larry Lamb and Phil James, two historians in their own right that had a family that was pushed off of Shenandoah or had family indirectly affected by its establishment. You'll hear some resounding interviews with them later in the program, but for right now, we want to start with Christy's history lesson of the park. As Christy pointed out, this region has had a detailed history that goes very far back even before the park was ever even thought of. Even with a deep-rooted history, this was the area chosen to piece together over 3,000 individual tracts of land purchased or condemned by the Commonwealth of Virginia and then presented to the federal government. These were farmers' homes and orchards. These were school buildings that taught a community. These were old churches that served a congregation. These were real people losing their real homes. So, just how was Shenandoah picked as a place for a national park?
Thank you.
Sizer was sent to study the mountain residents in Nicholson, Weekly, Corbin, and Richard Hollows, and to make recommendations as solutions to problems inherent in relocation. She was hired by men like George Pollock and William Carson that were some of the richest and most well-known residents of the Shenandoah Valley. Sizer's work was extremely influential in the decision to seize or buy land for the federal establishment of a park. So despite the fact that their ancestors were pushed off their land and in most cases had their home that they knew all their lives destroyed in front of them to keep them from returning, the descendants had put a lot of effort into preserving the history and culture of their ancestors. Now, we get to hear from some of these people that were more personally affected by the establishment of the park. So, even though these two men both have a somewhat different history with what happened to their families after the establishment, they have come together and worked tirelessly on one passion, preserving the history of a proud and wonderful people. The Lamb Family History Museum that Larry mentioned is a collection of original log cabins and items that have been recovered and restored to display to guests. Everything in the cabins is from in and around the time when people were pushed off Shenandoah in the 1930s or earlier. On our webpage, we have a collection of pictures from where the log cabins are and where we interviewed Phil and Larry, and I would strongly recommend that you see them. And now, what do you do for people that have stories like that? Phil only had a second-hand experience with hearing the story of someone having the chance to see their home again after not being there for such a long time and being forced to leave it. You have these stories and a history that may have been done in a secondhand way while researching, but how different is it when you have a profound personal connection with this history? And here, I would like to preserve the last part of our interview from Larry. And so, that ends our show. Again, this is Shadow of Shenandoah, a PEC Fellows podcast, and I am Andrew Olive. Now, we would like to thank our mentor for this project, Christy Kendall, and all the work she has done to help us. We'd also like to thank the Piedmont Environmental Council for giving us this wonderful opportunity to work with some amazing people and do very meaningful work, along with all the work they continue to do for historical preservation for the Piedmont area and all across Virginia. We would also like to thank the people we interviewed, Christy, Larry, and Phil. Thank you so much for giving us your time and knowledge to help produce this podcast. Thank you.